This is a two-dimensional representation. So fields in the representation are two-component vector. So the fundamental representation is a representation of dimension two. Okay? So elements in this representation are vectors with two components. Okay? Now, the group SU2 acts on this representation, on this vector space. Linearly, so elements of the group are represented as 2x2 matrices. So in particular, the generators, so there are, it means that there are 2x2 matrices with some specific constraint. So in particular, the generators TA, A equal 1 to 3 of SU2, are indeed 2x2 matrices. In this basis, represented, for instance, by TA equal 1/2 of sigma A, with sigma A the Pauli matrices. Okay? Now, in the adjoint representation, the adjoint representation of SU2 is an dimension 3 vector space. So elements in the adjoint representation, vectors are vectors, so I denote them, for instance, phi. In this representation are vectors represented by component phi A, are vectors with three components. Well, that can be represented, for instance. Well, these are the components, but they can be, of course, represented as 2x2 matrices by writing that phi A, that phi equals sum over A of phi A TA. So this is a representation of the adjoint, of an element of the adjoint representation in terms of 2x2 matrices. Okay. And now, SU2 acts in this representation on this vector space by three by three matrices. So in particular, the generators of SU2 are now represented by matrices TA relative to the adjoint representation, okay, that are 3x3 matrices, so whose elements are themselves labeled by the A and the B. Okay, so in fact, you may consider that a matrix TA, which is a generator of the same group, but in the adjoint representation, is a matrix TA adjoint with matrix element BC. So this is relative to the matrix, the generator, and those are the matrix element. And of course, well, in the adjoint representation, this is nothing but the antisymmetric, fully antisymmetric tensor. So that's what Anna teach you. So you see, so viewing the generator of SU3 in the adjoint representation as matrices, they can be represented as 3x3 matrices, but there are three of them. And here are the matrix elements of the generator A in the basis of the TB species. You see? Okay. And if you write this like that, you check that, for instance, that if you apply a generator TA in the adjoint representation to a vector phi, well, and you write that phi is given by this matrix, you recover, well, or rather, if now you take, sorry, now if you take a generator alpha in the adjoint representation defined by a linear combination of the generator in the adjoint representation, okay? And if you see how this generator in the adjoint representation acts on a vector with three components, if you represent phi as two by two matrices, and if you represent alpha adjoint as a two by two matrices, exactly by writing that representing alpha adjoint as sum over alpha of the alpha A TS, so this is, then you get that this is simply the commutator of alpha with phi. So this is consistent. So you can represent, if you represent the elements, the vectors in the adjoint representation and the generators in terms of two by two matrices, you get the representation of the action of the SU2 group or of the SU2 algebra on elements of the adjoint representation as commutator, but you can represent it in an abstract way in terms of just the epsilon ABC, the constant of the group that contains the information between the commutator of the generator of the group, you see. Okay. Good. Another question was about what are the charges of the fields. And one has to remember that, in fact, it's better to speak about quantum numbers when we are dealing with the non-abelian groups. Okay. And because, in fact, when one speaks about the charge, it's usually associated to SU2, I'm sorry, to a U1 group of for the electromagnetism, and therefore you can speak of a charge when it's associated to a U1 subgroup of SU2. So we have seen that, in fact, for SU2, there are three currents, conserved currents, G mu A, A equal 1, 2, 3. So there are three kinds of charges. You integrate the currents over a space-like surface and you get a charge, as usual. So you have three different charges, if you want, QA, that forms a vector, Q1, Q2, Q3. But when you apply a global SU2 transformation, this charge mixes because they live in the in the adjoint representation. Yes? Sorry, can you?
This symbol A, alpha adjoint.
Well, it's just, let us say, a representation, you know. This is an abstract representation of an element of the... Pardon? Yeah, no, this is just, this is the generator of an SU2 transformation acting in the adjoint representation. And if I take a linear combination, I get a general element of the general form of a generator of SU2 group. So I get the general form of the representation of SU2 Lie algebra acting on this representation. So expressed, so here expressed in terms of components, this is a linear combination of 3 by 3 matrices whose matrix elements are locked. Now, if starting from those alpha A, I construct an equivalent object that I, let me call it alpha tilde, that is the 2 by 2 matrix obtained by taking those alpha and taking the linear combination of the TAs of the alpha, then the action of this object on this vector, if I represent phi as an element, as, for instance, let us say, this phi tilde, that is a 2 by 2 matrices, so then the action of the adjoint representation of phi, if you represent it in terms of 2 by 2 matrices, which is a particular representation, convenient representation of the elements of the adjoint representation, this is simply the commutator of the representation in terms of 2 by 2 matrices of elements of the adjoint representation. Okay, so let me go back to this point. So there are 3 charges, and this, they form a vector that belongs to the adjoint representation because it has 3 components, but these charges mixes if you perform a global SU2 transformation because they transform like, well, Q into, well, this vector, let us say Q becomes G, Q, G minus 1. So it's different from the case of U1, because for U1, you want to have only 1 charge. One charge and Q. And under a U1 transformation, Q transform exponential I alpha, Q E minus I alpha equal Q. So the charge is gauge invariant. And finally, let me elaborate a little bit on the fact that I said that the gauge boson carry charges. Why do gauge bosons carry charges? That's because you can repeat the calculation in the non-interacting theory by computing what is the current, G mu A, in the theory with fermions coupled to gauge field. So the current, and what you find, if I am not mistaken, oh, I have just not succeeded in printing the formula, but you can find it in the book. It's, so it's the usual psi dagger gamma mu T A psi, where psi are the fermion fields. So this is the contribution of the fermion to the current. That's the usual contribution you already had in the Dirac theory. But then you have a term coming from the Lagrangian for the gauge field. And this is epsilon ABC A mu, oh, I'm sorry, the field strength sensor F mu nu B A nu C. If you compute, just it's just a straightforward contribution. So you see that there is a contribution to the current, therefore to the charge, the density of charge per element of volume, if you are interested into the 0 component of G mu, that gives you the density of charge, coming from gauge bosons, the gauge field. And of course, in SU, in U1, where this is zero, the fundamental constant of the U1 group is zero because it's an abelian group, this term is not present. The phantoms are neutral. Okay. Okay. So, after those reminders, let me go back to the action we wrote last time for SU2. So, the action was, and let me concentrate just now on the pure part of the, so I consider a pure SU2, well, let me use this blackboard first. So I consider a pure SU2 gauge theory, since it's an interesting theory now in sound, since gauge field interacts. So the action was so we had, remember, a gauge field A mu that had three components. The gauge field belongs to the adjoint representation of SU2. And we can represent it as sum over A of A mu TA. A mu ATA, where TA are the generators, 2 by 2 matrices. And the action, if you want, or if you want to write the Lagrangian, the action is minus 1 over g squared, 0 factor 2, integral d4x, f mu nu a, f u nu a. Well, I raise and lower the operators, the Lorentz, according to the metric h mu nu, which is minus 1, plus 1, plus 1, plus 1. And raising and lowering operators associated to the color is just by a delta function. So there is nothing, you do nothing just to have a consistent notation. Okay? And we have seen that this field strength, the field strength, F mu nu, is now non-trivial because it is related to it is nonlinear, so F mu nu is given by D mu A nu minus D nu A mu minus I, the commutator of A mu and A nu, if you represent A mu as by 2 by 2 matrices. And if you want to write it in terms of component, that's better for explicit calculation. This is the ordinary exterior derivative that you get for the Maxwell theory. But then you get an additional term that is nonlinear in the gauge potential that involves the structure constant of the group here, epsilon ABC, because we are dealing with SU2. Okay. And we have seen that, in fact, if we rescale A by a factor G, if we write A GA, well, this action becomes, this can be viewed as a free term, and this as a interaction term. So you get a free part this action, which is the ordinary Maxwell term, as for, which means as if we were treating the three component as independent Maxwell field obeying a U1 symmetry. But then we have a three vertex part involving AA and DAs, and a four vertex, if you want, of part involving AAAA, coming from the fact that when I take the square of this, I multiply this by this, or I multiply this by this. Okay. So, but the point is that this is over the G, and this will be over the G squared. So the idea is to treat this in perturbation theory. Because we expect that when G is small, when the coupling constant is small, the fluctuations of the gauge field are not very big, and the leading term is a quadratic term involving dAs, that is the same as the Maxwell field. And then treat the nonlinear coupling coming from the fact that we have a non-abelian gauge theory in perturbation theory, as we did for the 5-4 theory, or as you did for quantum electrodynamics when introducing the coupling to the Dirac field. Okay. Now, of course, if we try to do that, we have to be careful, exactly as we had to be careful in quantum electrodynamics, because all not A mu are physically inequivalent. We have the gauge, the local gauge symmetries of the theory, gauge symmetry, or gauge invariance, if you want, of the theory, which means that, in fact, describing the physics of the system by a gauge potential contains a lot of redundancy. So the gauge potential, A mu, contains a lot of redundant information. Because simply, when you perform a gauge transformation, you don't change the content of the field strength, except by a global factor. And that's the electric and the magnetic part, field that contains the information. Okay. So that's exactly like it's the same, that's exactly the same than the case of the U1 Maxwell field. Okay. And in particular, this means that if you consider the linear part, so if we take just the linear part of the quadratic part of the action, exactly like for the Maxwell field, it can be written as so the S over the two part, let us say, it can be written as d4x. This times this, so this is d mu a nu minus d nu a mu a squared, let's say, because you sum both over mu, nu's, and a independently. Sum over mu, nu, and a. Well, you can rewrite this as an integral over a mu a nu a, some kernel mu nu, which is some kernel here is the same than for the, or let us say, that's the same than for the U1 gauge field. So in Fourier space, in Fourier transform, this kernel K mu nu depends on K, on the momentum, and this is just minus K squared H mu nu plus K mu times K nu. That's exactly like for SU2. So the propagator of the gauge field, so if you are interested in computing the correlation between two gauge field with index mu and nu and the component with the gauge index A and B, since you are summing over the same A here, you would get a delta AB. And then you expect to have the inverse of this operator. But the problem is that as exactly as for the U1 field, this propagator is not inversible. K mu nu has zero modes. K mu nu of K has a lot of zero modes, since K mu nu of K times K nu is always zero. And of course, this corresponds to the fact that the polarization, you can take an excitation of the gauge field that has a longitudinal polarization, and then it doesn't change the energy if you want. Okay? So that's the usual problem. That's exactly like in U1 theory. Yes? Oh, that's simply that I can rewrite this as, well, up to two factors two, as integral d4x, a mu a nu b, I will have a delta a b, and then I will have an operator that is the Fourier transform of that, so it will be the Laplacian times h mu nu minus d mu in you. So exactly like when we can write d phi squared as minus phi, well, phi minus Laplacian phi up to boundary terms, and consider that when we compute the propagator, we have to invert this propagator. This is the propagator of the scalar part of the scalar field. Here, the propagator of the gauge field will be the inverse of this differential operator. Okay. Exactly. Simply now, this is a differential operator that acts on the field, but in addition, it acts also on the Lorentz component and on the group component of the field. So it's diagonal in the group component, so it's just three times the same operator, but still it acts on the four Lorentz thing. Yes? Yes? Okay.
So here we're working in the Minkowski space, right?
Yes.
And we have this problem of non-invertibility of your kernel.
Yes.
What about if I work this in the Euclidean formalism? Will I have the same problem of not being possible?
In which?
In
the that's exactly the same problem. Yes,
yeah,
it's not. Yes, because simply instead of taking here the Minkowski metric, take the Euclidean metric, you still have this. You see? Simply because the Laplacian is always defined as, well, in is always defined of d mu, d nu, H mu nu. You see? And so, and if you apply a d mu here, or if you want in the Fourier space, and k squared is the, in fact, k squared is always defined as h mu nu, k mu, k nu. And that's irrespective of the fact that you take the Minkowski metric or the Euclidean metric. So it's a generic problem. And that's, in fact, the generic problem of gauge fixing. If you want to do the calculation, better to choose a gauge.
So the problem comes from the second term, right? I mean, changing the metric will only change one of the eigenvalues of your Laplace. So what you're saying is that the problem is the d mu that appears.
No. The problem is simply that if you make a gauge transformation on the gauge potential, you do not change the physical content of the state, the classical state. You know, to a gauge potential configuration is associated some classical state configuration of your field if it obeys the Maxwell equation or the Young-Mills equation. Okay. If you perform a gauge transformation, a local gauge transformation, this is expected to describe exactly the same physical state. Exactly like in Maxwell's theory, you start from a gauge configuration. It corresponds to a configuration of the electromagnetic field with some electric field and some magnetic field. If you make a gauge transformation, this doesn't change the value of the electric field and the magnetic field. So it's the same physical transformation. So performing a gauge local gauge transformation is just parametrizing in different ways through the gauge potential the same physical field configuration. So that's what I mean by saying that because of local gauge invariance, AMU contains a lot of redundant information. So it's exactly the same problem than in electromagnetism. Nothing new here. Simply, the group of gauge transformation, the set of gauge transformation is bigger because we have now three gauge fields and we can mix them. So in addition to the gauge transformation that acts as usual in each component, we can make gauge transformations that mixes the component of the gauge potential. Okay? Yes?
Is energy then associated with each charge? There is some sort of gauge orbit that
you Yes, have. That's what I'm going to explain.
So can you mix every element of the gauge orbit into another element of the other gauge orbit?
Or no.
Is there some sort of
No, there's still, as for quantum electrodynamics, there are gauge orbits that are inequivalent. There are gauge configuration that describes different physical configuration of the electric and the magnetic field. So that's what I'm going to explain. So, of course, what we must do, both to study physics, if you want to solve the Maxwell equation, in general, you must choose a gauge. And to perform quantization, as for quantum electrodynamics, as for the Maxwell theory, you must choose a gauge. So you must perform a gauge fixing. Okay? And I'm going to describe that a bit more globally, but as usual, you can perform the same gauge fixing than for electrodynamics. So you can take the Coulomb gauge, which means that you take the special components of the gauge potential, namely A1. So if A is A0, A1, A2, A3, the spatial components are just the last three components. And you can take that's a gradient of A is equal to 0. You can take what is called the axial gauge. Axial gauge means that you fixed the first component of A to be zero. So it's a gauge where you have no electromagnetic potential, simply have gauge potential. But you can still have an electric field because electric fields can come out from time derivative of the gauge potential. That's, you can have a displacement current that creates. And you have also the Lorentz gauge that is fully relativistically covariant. That is d mu of a mu equals zero. And you have other gauges more involved, but we shall be mostly dealing with the Lorentz gauge. And of course, well, the difference in our case is simply that you have to enforce a gauge condition for each configuration of the field. For each component, I'm sorry, for each gauge component, component of the gauge field. And of course, you may choose a gauge fixing component different from the different A's, but that wouldn't be a good idea because this will break the global SU2 invariant that you have. So better to take gauge fixing that is the same for the different A. Okay?
So the Coulomb gauge gives you static solutions.
No. I don't think so. No, you can take the Coulomb gauge and you can get it's useful to compute static solution, but you can perfectly solve the equation of motion, the Maxwell equation and everything, you know, for compute A mu using a Coulomb gauge. Yeah. Okay. Well, of course, there is a little problem, well, an important problem that I have not discussed, that whether those gauge fixing conditions that are here defined locally can be defined globally on your whole space-time. And that's a question that is a bit subtle. In fact, there are important effects associated to whether you can fix the gauge globally or not. The axial gauge is okay. Here you have subtleties for the Langevin gauge, as well, especially associated to non-abelian gauge series. But I'm not going to discuss that. Okay. Good. So now let me discuss a geometrical picture of what means gauge fixing, gauge invariance. Okay, so what we have to do, let me start here to discuss what we want to do with quantization. So we want to perform quantization on our gauge field using a functional integral. All what I'm going to do can be performed in the canonical formalism, but that's more complicated to discuss. And the functional integral formalism is very well suited to discuss how you must quantize the gauge theory. So what I want to do is basically to define a functional integral over the space of gauge configuration. Here I'm a bit sketchy. Over a big space, that is the space of all gauge configuration of exponential I times the action, the Young Mills action. The action I wrote here for the gauge field. Okay? And A here, the curly letter A, this is a big space, yes?
Talk about these three gauges. Yes. For example, for Maxwell theory, if you impose that gauge, then you know that you can, because you can always find a solution to your gauge fixing equation. In this case, when A is a non-abelian gauge field, when you gauge transform the field, you have a commutator, right?
Yes.
So what guarantees that I can impose these three conditions in this general setting?
No, no. Either you infer this condition or this condition
either,
or this condition.
Either of those, how do you know that you can actually do that?
I will show you that. Well, it's related. Well, locally, you can always do that. Globally, it's a bit of another question. But I'm going to show you how it works. Okay, so here I have some big space, A, you see, which is a space of gauge potential configurations. See? A. So a point here is a gauge configuration that I denote in a very sketchy way, A. A means just the data of all the AMU A's of X for all the point X in space-time. Let us call this M for Minkowski. Mu equal 1 to 4 and A equal 1 to 3. Okay. I don't specify what is this functional space. Well, you have to be a mathematician to work out. So, but at that level, I just discussed, it's some big functional space. You have to specify the condition on the function, the norm, etc. But I won't discuss that. Okay. So now, of course, you may perform gauge transformation. You know that now you have a space that I will call G. So A is a space of gauge configuration A. Now, I have a big group G that is the group of local gauge transformations. You see? What is a local gauge transformation? So, an element G belongs to this big group G of local gauge transformation. So it means that G is the data of elements of SU2 for each point of spacetime. Okay, so M is just Minkowski spacetime. Well, or Euclidean, if you are space-time. Okay? And so I denote by G, in fact, a collection of elements of G of X associated to each point of space-time. So it denotes a general local gauge transformation. So and this big group G is, of course, just a copy of SU2 associated to all X. So you can write formally G as a copy for all X belonging to M of SU2. It's just a direct product of SU2 associated to each of the points of space-time. You see? Well, that's just a mathematical sketchy notation for that. Okay? And now you know that G acts on A, on this space of gauge potential, because simply if you have a given A, a given point here, you take a G, a group transformation in this capital G group, and you get a gauge transformed gauge field configuration that is given by, you remember our notation, G times A times G minus 1 minus I G D of G minus 1. And this is just a sketchy notation for stating that remember our form of the local gauge transformation. We have a local gauge transformation where A mu is transformed into G of X. So A mu of X, G of X, A mu of X, G minus 1 of X, minus I G of X, D mu of G minus 1 of X, where now this is a 2 by 2 matrix, and G of X is a 2 by 2 matrix. OK, so I write in a very sketchy notation A of G like G A G minus 1 minus I G times D G minus 1. So this has been understood that you take G of X at any point of X, A of X at the same point of X. This is the derivative with a mu component if you consider the A mu component of A mu. So it's a sketchy notation for that. And so G acts on A, which means that if you make a gauge transformation, let me choose some height. I get another gauge configuration, which is physically equivalent. Okay. So I get a subspace of A spanned by all the gauge transform configuration out of a given gauge configuration. So this is called an orbit of the gauge group. You see? That's all the gauge potential configurations that are physically equivalent by gauge transformation to the original A. And you can define it as, for instance, the image of A by G. Of A by the action of the gauge group capital G. OK. Good. So now, of course, you have other inequivalent gauge orbits. Yes?
So this orbit is the orbit for that specific element A under
yes.
The action of small g or?
No,
just
globally of all the g's.
Of all
the g's. If you take small g, you will get just a little.
But
neighboring.
If you apply that, okay, but that
but if you apply that again, 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 since G is a group, you get all the orbit out of applying successive small transformation. Okay? Okay. So, but we know that, for instance, the action is a gauge invariant, so the action here, here, and here are the same. S of A equal S of AG. But now if you consider another A prime here, here you have A prime of G. In general, the action will be different because those are different gauge configurations. OK. Yes?
Can you have any sort of overlap between orbits?
What do you mean by overlap?
Like, I don't know, they're telling you.
As they cross each other? You mean you have two orbits that cross each other? No, because if two orbits cross each other, it means that these points and these points are equivalent to gauge transformation. You can perform this gauge transformation and then this gauge transformation.
Okay.
So, in fact, those, no. If you are doing that, you are, the three points are on the same orbit. Okay? So they cannot cross. So these orbits form what is called a foliation. You know, the orbits. So let us denote now the space of orbits. So the space of orbits formally, we can write it as A quotiented by the big gauge group G. You see? And the space of orbits form the foliation of A. That's what the mathematics will call the foliation. You separate the big, your big space into sheets, if you want. I don't know what's the name exactly. So this picture is very clear. Okay. And now, in fact, since these represent the space of physical configuration, what we would like to do is to integrate over the orbits instead of integrating over the whole space. Yes?
Is there a reason to think of the different configurations of the same orbit as representing the same physical situation as opposed to representing different situations that we can't distinguish between?
Pardon? I'm sorry, you speak a bit too quickly for me.
Is there a reason to think of different configurations on the same orbit?
Yes.
As being different representations of the same situation as opposed to being different situations that we can't distinguish between?
You cannot switch? No, I'm sorry. I'm not sure I understood your question.
If you can't distinguish between them, they're no different to you.
No.
To you.
I think that's a bit the same question of you.
No. The question is that should we think of different gauge configurations that are on the same orbit?
Yes.
Should we think of them as being different representations of the same physical situation?
Or yes.
Is there a reason to think of
yes.
that? No, wait. Is there a reason to think of them that way rather than to think of them as being different possible situations that we can't distinguish between?
No, we can't physically distinguish between them.
No, we can't.
But no, we can't. We cannot.
Yes.
So should we think of them as being two different situations which we can't distinguish between, or as being exactly the same situation?
No, they are exactly the same.
So why can't we think of them as being two different situations that we
That's
just can't
because
distinguish?
Because we are representing our field configurations through A because it's much more convenient. And in particular, this guarantee locality. You see, the action here involves only, the original action involves only A's and derivatives of A. So it's an original classical action that is local in space-time. And if you try to describe things using a gauge fixing in general, well, in classically, this turns out to be true, but quantum mechanically, it will become more difficult. It's usually not clear that you have a local description. And locality is very important when quantizing quantum fields because you need to keep locality in order to keep causality. You see, you still need that operator at space-like separated points, commute, or anti-commute is their fermions, so that you can have no signaling faster than light transmission of information in a modern language. You see. So locality is very important. And that's one of the reasons why the description of gauge field in terms of gauge potential is very useful. It's because it's local from scratch.
But isn't there a reason to think of the gauge as being a real thing and different gauges are different situations that we can't
No. You must always remember that the gauge symmetry is not a physical symmetry of the theory. It's a way to encode your physical system in different way. In some sense, gauge invariance plays the same role than diffeomorphism invariance in general relativity. You know, changing a system of coordinates, local system of coordinates, to describe the gravitational field or the gravitational field plus matter, in fact, doesn't change your configuration. We know from equivalence principle that going in different local frames describes the same physics. Here, that's exactly the same thing. You know, using different gauges or looking at describing the configuration near here or here is a bit like using different frame, local frame of references, not in space-time, but in the space of gauge configurations.
If you make that claim, then that implies that the gauge is not a real physical thing, which you're not, in fact, saving locality by using it. There's not, in fact, a local interaction with a gauge field if the gauge is not a real physical thing which can be.
No. Some of the gauge components will carry physical interaction, but some will not. That's the point. Okay, go on. I hope it will become clear later. Okay. But all the questions you are asking, you may ask them already in Maxwell's theory. They are not specific to gauge theories. Gauge theories, we have more degrees of freedom, more gauge transformation, but the idea is the same. So the idea goes back to Maxwell and the description of the electromagnetic field in terms of a gauge potential instead of just electric and magnetic field. Okay. So what we want to do is, in fact, since there are many, many gauge configurations that are the same, we would like to replace this by some integral over A over G. Because then, in particular, we won't have this problem. Because the fact that there are zero modes in the propagator of the gauge fields is simply that when you make a gauge transformation, when you consider two different gauge configurations that are on the same orbit, the action doesn't change. So if you compute the second derivative of the action in this direction, you get zero. The action doesn't change. The first derivative of the action doesn't change. But the second derivative of the action doesn't change either. So these directions are the zero modes, correspond to the zero modes of the second derivative of the gauge action. Okay? So this problem reflects just the fact that you are doing that. Okay.
I just had a quick question. Can we think of this A over G group as the quotient group? Like,
yes, okay. It's just, it's not a group.
It's not a group.
It's a quotient space. We have a big space, we have a big group that acts on this space, and we quotient by the action of the group. We get the group of inequivalent configuration, but it's not a group. Okay. So this is a quotient space of, if you want, physically inequivalent, or physical, if you want, simply, of physical configurations. Exactly like the fact that the space of metric on a manifold divided by the action of the deformation group gives the space of inequivalent Riemannian metric on a space. See? That's exactly the same thing, geometrically. Okay. So, I'm going slowly, but that's important to understand that. So it's not a problem. Okay, so now, of course, this is a description, a global description, and why gauge fixing? What is the action of the gauge fixing? You know, what is the gauge fixing doing? So, performing a gauge fixing is something very simple. Performing a gauge fixing is just choosing a possibly unique gauge configuration on each orbit, on each slice. So for instance, if you consider the Lorentz gauge, I know that there will be hopefully one configuration of A among all those that satisfies the Lorentz gauge condition. Here it is. For this one, there will be another configuration satisfying the Lorentz gauge. Okay, another one, another one. So by imposing the Lorentz gauge configuration, we select a subspace like that, yes?
In the Lorentz gauge didn't completely fix my, don't I still have the freedom of adding harmonic functions to A and still not changing?
Of course, so there are subtleties. There are subtleties, but those subtleties are associated to global structure of spacetime. So for instance, you can say that's perfect. I can add to A mu something that satisfies that is an harmonic function. But the question is, can you define an harmonic function on the whole spacetime? And if you compactify spacetime, for instance, to consider that spacetime is a sphere, then you know that the only harmonic function is the constant function. So the question you are asking is a question of global. And if you take, for instance, the axial gauge, then it doesn't involve any derivative, so you cannot have zero mode or something. So in that case, you have no problem. Okay. But, well, basically, the idea is that by choosing a gauge, you select a gauge slice. So you are slicing your space by some submanifold that is orthogonal to the orbits of the gauge group. So you see, so view this as a big, big, big space. In fact, it's infinitely dimensional with some dimension. This is a submanifold, an orbit, which has some dimension, subdimension. And this is a gauge slice. The gauge slice must have the same co-dimension as this one, so that the sum of this dimension is the dimension of zero. So in some sense, they have to be orthogonal in some sense. If they are not orthogonal, this means that you get into the kind of problem that you are dealing. Okay. So gauge fixing means that you are stay on a gauge slice. Okay? Yes?
Gauge fixing guarantee you that one unique slice, or you could have...
Well, you have to be sure that by choosing a gauge condition, you have a unique gauge slice and you don't do something like that, for instance, or that you do not forget some of the modes. And those are a bit delicate question, but locally, this ensures that. Locally, that's true. Now, for instance, the question is that choose another the axial gauge. And for the axial gauge, we are on a safe ground. We know that, for instance, this is a gauge slice associated to the Lorentz gauge, and this is another gauge slice associated to another condition. So for instance, this is a gauge slice associated to the axial gauge. And this is a gauge slice associated to the Lorentz gauge. OK? Yes?
What sort of conditions would your gauge condition have to satisfy in order to ensure that you pick out a single configuration on every orbit?
Well, that's the condition you just mentioned. It has to. But it's, in general, a global problem that is difficult.
There's no obvious way to tell whether you're picking out a unique one.
Yeah, but then you have to check that globally in your space of configuration, you don't have a nasty gauge configuration that is doing something like that. OK? Okay.
Is there any easy way to tell whether it
does? It's a difficult. In fact, it's a kind of it's a topological problem, and it turns out for the Maxwell field. In fact, most of those Coulomb gauge works fine, at least if you enforce that at infinity. Your gauge configuration is well behaved, so you have no monopole, Dirac monopole, or things like that. For the SU2 non-abelian gauge series, in fact, in the Lorentz gauge, you do have a phenomenon like that. But I won't discuss that. It's related to for some special gauge configurations that have a topological number, some kind of analog of monopole configuration. Okay, so I'm not discussing that. I will assume. So for the moment, I will assume that this is not a problem. Okay? But you are right to ask the question. So we stay on a gauge slice. And so, yes?
This is still something that is not clear to me, that if I impose either of these three conditions, how do I know that I won't get a trivial orbit in that space?
What do you mean by a trivial orbit?
That I cannot impose that gauge because I cannot find two elements or two potentials that can be related by that gauge transformation.
Now, well, if you have one element, you can always apply the gauge configuration. Right. And generally, it changes.
So yeah, OK, but if I'm fixing my gauge, right, if I take that condition over there,
yes.
What guarantees that
I see.
The,
you mean you may assume that sometimes it's not possible. Yes. Well, you have to check that too. That's a good question. But with the axial gauge, so there is at least one gauge where you are ensured that you can always do that. Because you can check that making such a gauge transformation, you can always, if you look just at one component, A naught, let's say A naught, or G, you can always find G that satisfies this condition. Okay. Here you have to be a bit more careful. So you are entitled to ask this question. But the answer is that that's fine, at least if you are looking at gauge configurations that are not too far from the flat, the vacuum configuration where A mu is equal to zero. You see? Okay, so let's just assume that it's possible, at least if A mu A is not so close to zero, which is the vacuum field configuration. Okay? And since we are in fact going to try to quantize in order to be able to do perturbation theory, at that level of the discussion, that's all what you need, that we need for. Okay. So gauge fixing means to stay on a gauge slice. And well, in Maxwell theory, what you did when quantizing the Maxwell theory was just choosing a Lorentz gauge, enforcing this condition or this condition on the field, and applying the rules of quantization. And it works fine. And it works fine because for the Maxwell theory, for the non-abelian, for the abelian gauge field, you can take a configuration like that and make your functional integration restricted on this slide or on these slides, and it gives the same result. The problem with non-abelian gauge theory is that if you do this naive gauge fixing, so you gauge fix and you integrate over the A that satisfies this condition, different gauge slice give different result. You see? And that's not surprising. It's simply that in general, we have a big space, we have some complicated measure on this space, and integrating the volume is well defined, but integrating the surface of the slice or integrating the surface of another slice gives you different result. No, the surface of a triangle and the surface of the same things are different. Okay. But this means that taking a naive measure doesn't work. One has to be more clever. to define an integration procedure that starts from this measure here, and that gives a correct measure. So the question is, what is the measure? Which measure? Okay. And for that, well, I just have time to discuss a bit the beginning. Then we have to, okay, no, that's fine. We are on Wednesday, so we have to still have time. So let me write, let me use a bit of formalism. I will denote a gauge fixing condition, a gauge fixing condition, or constraint if you want, by enforcing that there is a function on A that I will call F of A, such that the gauge function condition means that F of A equals 0. You see? And by F of A, what I mean is that, in fact, F of A means some function that depends on, so we have in fact three gauge fixing conditions, FA, depending on A, on d mu A, possibly of the other derivative of A, because you can take a gauge condition involving more than one derivative of the gauge potential, at point X, for all X in space-time. You see? So, for instance, for the Lorentz gauge, what means FA of A, d mu A, etc. at point X is simply d mu of A, sorry, d mu of A mu A of X. So it's simply the function that associates to each point and to each group index A, the divergence of A mu, of the A component of A mu at point X. You see? But I denote that in a very compact form by a function F of A. You see? So it's a set of functions. And for instance, you see, so F of A equals 0 picks our things here. So F of A is in fact a functional from A to, let us say, just M times times the Lie algebra of the gauge group, if you want, because we have one constraint for A for each X. Okay. Okay. Yes?
So is the strategy to integrate over this quotient space? Or
yes.
Are you integrating over the,
yes,
the gauge slices?
Yes. Yes, so that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to separate the integration over the Wolf-Swoosh space into an integration of the gauge slice and an integration over the orbits. Okay? So what I'm going to do is to separate this into an integration over the slice times an integration over the orbits. Okay? And I'm trying to do that in a consistent way. Good. And so let me show show you how this is done. Being on a gauge slice means that f of a equals 0, you see. So being on the gauge means that I want that f of a equals 0. Now I know that for any a here, for any a, if I worked well, for any a, there is a gauge equivalent AF that satisfies F of AF equals 0. So here is A, and so here is the A I started from, and here is my AF. So I have an A that satisfies the gauge condition, and that is gauge equivalent to AF. So it means that it is on the same orbit. You see, AF is equivalent to A on the same orbit. So it means that, so this is equivalent to say that there is a G in the gauge group. There is a gauge transformation. It exists a gauge transformation. Such that A of G, which remember is G A G minus 1 minus I G D G minus 1, satisfies AF. So such that F of A of G is equal to 0. Okay? You see, so there is a gauge transformation here, G, that sends your A onto the gauge slice. Of course, this G depends on the original A. So this G depends on A, of course. So let me call it and of F of the gauge slice. If we had considered another gauge condition, it would be another G. So let me denote in a very sketchy way. Let me denote this G, GF of A. So this means that to any A, we associate GF of A, so this belongs to, this is in the group of, this is an element of the gauge group, such that F of A of GF of A equals 0. Okay, you see. Its notation is a bit heavy, but this means simply this. Okay? And let us assume that this GF of A is unique. Let me assume that I don't have one G, another G here. I am in this situation. Okay. So it's in general a complicated function. Now I show you how to compute re-express the functional integral in terms of this GFA. And that's a procedure that was in fact devised by Fadeyev and Popov, and also by Feynman and Rice-DeWitt in the States in the 60s. Okay. So I want to start from this big integral, dA of exponential I of S of A. And let me do something stupid. Let me first write the fact that I can write the integral over all the gauge group. So this is an integral over the gauge group. I write the integral over the gauge group. And I write just that if I integrate over the gauge group with some measure that I will describe, and I write just a delta function of G and of GF of A, this is one. So this is a delta function Dirac, delta function on the gauge group. And this will be, in fact, a measure on the gauge group. But remember, the gauge group is just the product. Where is it written? Yes, here it is. The gauge group is just a tensor product of copies of SU2. So you can take as a measure formally DG, this measure. You can take to be simply the products of all points in space-time of the measure d mu of g of x, where this is the what is called the R measure on SU2. This is a measure that is invariant under rotation. There is a unique measure on SU2. So on any compact simple Lie group, there is a unique measure called the R measure, well, on any compact, that is I'm going very slowly, but that's fine. That's important. Okay. So let us write that, and I will end up here. So this is a triviality, you see. One is the integral over a whole space of the Dirac measure of G with a given point. I have my big group. This is the gauge group. Here I have a given point GF of A. And if I integrate it over the whole group with a Dirac measure here, I get one. Okay. And let me insert this in the functional integral. So let me insert this into integral over dA exponential I S of A. And let me insert this one by writing that I insert G of G delta of G and of GF of A. So this is equal to the original path integral. You see? What we are going to do tomorrow is to use gauge invariance and to perform gauge transformation both on A, here and here, to transform this into what we are going to do tomorrow is to see that we can use gauge invariance to transform this integral into an integral where I have an integral over all the A when I fixed the gauge condition, because gf of A is defined by the fact that f of gf of A is equal to 0 times some measure depending on A that we have to determine, times the exponential of I s of A, the original term that is gauge invariant, times an integral over the gauge group. So we are going to make transformations so that the integral over the gauge groups that originally depends on A becomes independent of A and comes out of the big functional integral at the price of that now the A satisfies the gauge condition. So you see, so the idea is that instead of integrating over that, I integrate over the gauge group times an integration over all the Fs that satisfy the gauge condition. But being careful when doing that, there is an additional measure term that depends on A, depends on F, the gauge condition. And that's the famous Fadeyev-Popov determinant that we are going to compute tomorrow. Yes?
We have some
function d of A, let us say. I call it a measure, so it's a some metric. I have some mu of A, let us say. Some density measure. Density is some kind of density measure. Yes, that's just some density measure. Okay. Yes. Okay, but I have no time. I'm already late. So let's do that quietly tomorrow. You'll see that once we have this bit abstract formalism with delta function on functional space and an infinite dimensional group, the calculation can be done, in fact, quite easily. And we get a very interesting result. Okay, thank you.